Thank you, Phil. I just wanted to make a small comment and say I think you expressed eloquently in your speech the disappointment and disgust that we have and continue to feel when we look at this talk that we continue to feel towards it. It's absolutely disgrace. You look around this country, 90 children per week go into care. It's another lack of any responsibility this government has shown. I think it, and Bernie said this, I need to repeat it, it shows completely how little they care. That was not mentioned once in that budget speech at the crisis in children's services. And I think it's to be commended that's at the centre of this budget, the absolute centre of it. Where the government wants to remove that safety net, I think this budget shows that we're determined to keep it there.
Okay, anybody else? No, okay, so I've moved the motion, the recommendation at the end of that motion. Is that seconded?
I'll second.
Okay, so all those in favour? Okay. Carry unanimously. Thank you very much for that. And as I say, further work to be done, but I think that's a good contribution to the Communion with Balance budget next year. So thank you for that. Right, now we now go back to the agenda as is, and item number 4, which is the Hoy Lake Golf Resort. If I could introduce this colleagues will want to make contributions. So this report outlines the Hoy Lake Golf Resort project. It sets out who the partners are. It summarises the assessment of the funding and viability plan and the requirement for prudential borrowing and the return on investment this will generate. It identifies how the highways works will be funded and recommends that Cabinet agrees to move to the next stage, which is the commissioning of a series of studies, which are set out in the report on page 6. You can see a whole range of studies: environmental impact, traffic impact, flood risk, habitat regulations, design and access, planning and regeneration, and economic impact. So commissioning these studies, and I think the key point to make is at no cost to the council. These studies will be funded by the developer. They will be independent and they will be open to the public to scrutinise. So in terms of the potential benefits of this project, the report sets these out. It's a £200 million scheme which will create in excess of 300 jobs and support businesses across the borough and contribute to our visitor economy, which is a very important economic sector for us. The report spells out that it's designed to be more than just two new golf courses. It's a project that will be a key leisure destination with a high quality hotel, restaurant, spa, and will be an attractive offer for conferences. The partners include some nationally and internationally renowned companies, i.e. Celtic Manor, Story Homes, which do have solid financial foundations. The project has the potential to generate significant additional revenue to the council. And we've just been talking in the budget resolution how important that is. So in this project is projected to generate over nearly £1 million in the form of council tax receipts and business rates. And just to repeat again, for the avoidance of doubt, this is crucial. Bringing more income to the council is crucial because after 2021, the main government grant completely disappears. So we are facing that cliff face financially, and unless we start the work now to replace that money, we will literally have to start closing down huge swathes of our services in 2021. So we need to look at how we're going to generate new income streams for the council. I think the important point to make is the report before us this morning is not proposing that any final decisions are made today about the project. People need to understand that. It's asking for cabinet agreement to the undertaking of a series of studies which I mentioned at no cost for the council. Potential borrowing requirements are set out in the report, which obviously has excited a number of contributions. will only be actioned once planning permission has been secured. So we are not agreeing any financial package today. I think that's a very important thing to say. Indeed, the whole of this project is subject to planning permission being agreed. I think that's important to highlight. I want to say that as a cabinet, we're committed to consulting with key stakeholders, such as residents and local businesses, on this scheme. We're also happy to consider alternative proposals, and I attended a public meeting a couple of Saturdays ago where the Hoylake Village Life Plan for an eco-golf resort was presented. We are meeting with those people very soon to talk about their ideas. And indeed, in the next year, while these various studies are being done, we are open to any other ideas that will enhance this project. So this is an opportunity for people to suggest those ideas. I absolutely understand that there's a group who simply don't want any this project to go ahead full stop, but I would say, given the potential significant economic benefits of this project to the borough, and given the potential additional income coming into the council coffers, as a responsible administration, I believe that we would be failing in our duty if we did not give it at least serious consideration. And that's all that we're being asked to do at the moment. The project needs to be based on an objective analysis of the evidence, and that's why it's important to commission the various studies that they that are outlined in the report. And the final comment I wanted to make in reducing the report is, you know, I want to make it clear that I do understand that some people have passionate views about this project. But can I say, I've received a number of emails, and my colleagues, I know, have received a number of emails in the last couple of weeks. And I think, regrettably, some of the tone of these emails have been bordering on the abusive and the threatening. I really do think that. And I would hope that whatever views people hold about this project, going forward, at least people should engage in the debate in a civilised way. And I just want to make that point. So those are the comments I want to make on the report. Any other contributions from cabinet members? Angie.
I'm just wondering if you can say I think this is the right thing to do, you know, to go to the next stage where these kind of detailed, independent reports will be undertaken to inform any future decision making by planning committee. You know, people are asking about these different matters, you know, around environmental concerns, flood risk, yeah, economic impact. Should this development come to fruition, it will be a real boost to the area in terms of employment, tourism and leisure infrastructure, as well as generating much needed revenue for the council to run vital services, as you just said in the early report. We will have no government money coming in at the end of 2020, so we do need to look doing things differently rather than negligently falling off the funding plan.
Okay, thanks, Andrew. Janice?
Yeah, thanks, Phil. I mean, I totally agree with what Angie's just said there. You know, we need to take this to the next stage and get all the concerns that have been expressed by our residents and also ourselves addressed. And if they are addressed satisfactorily, I just think it would be absolutely foolish not to go ahead and handle this. And I just, as cabinet member for finance, and in generation I too, I've had several emails yesterday and this morning around the potential borrowing. We can't use that money to pop it into our revenue budget and plug any deficit there that's being caused through the decrease in government funding coming to us. We can't do that. It's just not that simple. I'm more than happy for people to email me for me to go into greater detail around this, but I have to say that that's a really big misunderstanding that's currently taking place. We can't use that money to put it in our revenue budget and stop the cuts that are coming our way. So I just needed to say that. And also, the council will generate a minimum of 2.5 million from that borrowing. So So it's an income stream coming to us as well as a sound business decision.
Okay, thank you. Matthew?
Thank you, Phil. One of the questions last point I was going to make, which Ben's just covered there, I think that's really important that that there will be an income stream back to the council, even on the borrowing aspect. And I know that there are protections in place and extensive diligence has been done satisfactorily. The sort of point slash question I wanted to get across. I've been really grateful. I accept actually. I think some of the tone has been a bit much, but actually a lot of people have tried to engage quite positively on this. And I've been grateful for some of the sort of passion, guidance, and expertise from members of our public about concerns they've had. And I think it's really positive that as a cabinet that's been listened to, and that the conditions have been put in, and reports are being commissioned deliberately to make sure that the very concerns that have been raised publicly. Great concerns that in any way we completely share to make sure that our environment is protected and it's economically sound. I think it's a really important thing for our cabinet to listen to and as we have responded to. As you say, today's not a decision. Today is just saying, should we go and find out the information that we need to find out? I think it's entirely sensible to do that. But I wonder if you could just confirm for me that those environmental concerns that have been set out before, they will have to have a report that is satisfactorily accept that there won't be sort of undue damage, etc., to our environment before we can go ahead in terms of endangered species, etc., etc., and a number of other reports that come forward. Just clarity from you there would be helpful.
I can give that reassurance. And again, just to repeat, if people have an opportunity to read the report, you'll see on page 6 the list of studies that are being commissioned, and they include a full environmental impact assessment, they include a flood risk assessment including drainage, and they include habitat regulations assessment. So I think in terms of the environmental impact, I mean, look, you know, none of us on this cabinet want to damage the environment. Well, you know, that's a key, one of our key pledges. So we want to make sure that whatever development goes ahead does not do that, and that will be a key part of the evidence that will be gathered. But unless we commission the studies, unless we can see the evidence, how will we ever know one way or the other? That's the point I want to make. So yeah, we need to. Take this project forward based on an informed view of all of the impacts, not just environmental, but economic, social, etc. And that's what the next stage of this process is about. And as I say, I know people, as I said at the start, pulling the plug now, before we've even got the answers to those questions, I don't know why you would do that in a rational world, but there we go. Bernie.
Just to add to that,
though,
I don't think you've said it, but these reports are going to be reports, and they will be in the public domain. So whatever the reports say will be open to the public, so everything will be transparent as we go forward. I think as a responsible administration we have to take this, especially in light of what we just talked about with the budgets. But this is not going to be just a budgetary decision. You know, we welcome the income, it's going to be good for the world. If the conditions are correct, if the conditions are right, it's going to be good for the world. And just coming back onto the abusive emails that a lot of us have had, I've had some positive ones as well.
Yeah.
And I think the voice of the people who are in favour of this, or who would like to look at this positively, is being drowned out at the moment. So when we're listening to the emails that we've come from the opposition, I think it's important that we look at the emails that we have from people who are quietly in support of what's going on. The information will be in the public domain. All the reports that come through will be done from independent people, and they'll be in the public domain for the public to read. And Phil said something before as well, this will go to planning, it will be a planning decision. It'll go to planning, so it'll be a planning decision. So I support this. I think it's a sensible way forward, and it's just the first step.
Okay, any other comments? So I just want to reiterate that last point that Bernie's made. You know, if anybody was in any doubt about the serious financial position this council is in, you know, hopefully the first debate we had this morning should have raised the level of awareness. You know, we are facing literally a financial cliff edge, and we need to look at all opportunities to bring additional income into the council. And as I say, I think this is a sensible next stage. So if I ask Cabinet to look at recommendations, in terms of recommendations, please, on page 4, I'll just go through them. There are 3. The first one is that the Hoy Lake Golf Resort project progresses to the next stage, which allows the Nicholas Joint Venture Group to carry out the detailed studies at their cost to enable them to prepare a planning application for the project. Number 2, that subject to planning permission being secured, the golf resort development and all the conditions of the loan being satisfied by Nicholas Joint Venture Group as set out in this report, members approve the use of the council's access to prudential borrowing under the terms reported and agree to enter an investment agreement with the Nicholas Joint Venture Group. And 3, should the application for the Liverpool City Region Strategic Investment Fund for highways works be unsuccessful, to recycle the land received funding into a contribution to the construction of a new adopted public highway to open up the golf resort, provide a new link road to and from Hoy Lake to benefit the wider highway network and businesses and local residents. So those are the 3 recommendations. I'll move them and second it. All those in favour? That's agreed unanimously. Thank you very much for that. Okay, so moving on to the next item, which is item number 5, which is the budget decision. Item number 5 now is a budget decision, Council 5th of March procedure and rules. I'm not proposing to say anything on this, except to move the recommendations on page 15. Can we agree those recommendations? Agreed, thank you. Okay, we have done 6. So that takes us on then to item 7, which is Council Tax 2018-19, Tax Base, Discounts and Exemptions, and Council Tax Support Scheme. Janessa.
Thanks, Phil. Council has a legal obligation to set out its council tax base every year. This tells us how many properties we have on roll and how much income we can expect to raise through council tax. Excuse me. As you can see, as was mentioned before by George and some other colleagues, approximately 62% of all properties on will fall in bands A and B. And this results in a lower council tax base, and also it does restrict our ability to raise money from council tax as compared to other local authorities who might have much more expensive properties. We expect to collect approximately £122 million in council tax revenue in 2018-19. This does not include any future increase, either through the building of new properties or the decrease in people eligible for discounts. Our collection rate is currently 96.7% and we don't anticipate any change to that. The collection rate for residents who receive council tax support is less than that. We recognise the difficulty that low-income families and universal credit might create in terms of council tax debt. And our door is always open to help people with difficulties through debt advice, signposting to other agencies, and also through our council tax discretionary hardship relief fund, which we also have in operation. That came in 2013-14, when full council tax benefit was removed for people on in receipt of benefits and low incomes. It's another cruel trick played by this government to add to working age poor further distress to them and financial hardship. So it's only there, and based on our current policy, each case is assessed individually to take into account financial and personal mitigating circumstances. We consider if the circumstances are short term and sufficiently exceptional, and compared to others in a similar position, we will help, we will assist financially. There is a set of criteria people have to meet in order to qualify for this assistance, and I'm more than happy for people to make inquiries to me, and I will let people know. Council Tax Support Scheme, which I've just referred to, which was brought in 2013-14 to replace the old council, full council tax benefits, has been looked at again by officers, but it was felt that the substantive eligibility criteria does not need to be altered. However, the scheme will be reviewed in 2018 by the Business Overview and Scrutiny Committee. I'd just like to make a small amendment around what we award our refuge. Rural women and children's aid, that's page 50, should read 100%. So rural awards 100% council tax discount to our local refuge, which I think speaks volumes about our priorities here.
Yeah, yeah.
We recognise the work that the refuge does in terms of actually, it's not an exaggeration to say people are referred there when their lives are in danger. It was referred to as a temporary measure that we offer. Well, it might be temporary, but it's also life-saving, yeah, as I'm concerned. I did want to see whether or not other local authorities did the same, but distressingly, some local authorities don't even have refuges. So I'm really, really proud that A, we've got one, and B, that we're giving the full council tax discounts. Another thing I think we should be proud of here on Wirral is that as from April 2018, we propose to exempt all care leavers up to the age of 25 from council tax. This confirms Labour's commitment to looking after the most vulnerable when central government has literally abandoned them. So I'd like to think that we are putting our money where our mouth is, as opposed to central government. Don't seem to do anything for the vulnerable here on Wirral. I ask Pablo to approve the recommendations outlined at the beginning of this report on page 49.
Okay, thanks,
Jeanette.
Oh, sorry,
Chris, yeah. Thanks, Phil. Can I just say, looking at 3.5 on the table there, it really saddens me when you look at the cost of property in Wirral compared to richer parts of the country. And it's just a real reflection, isn't it, around the poverty and who the people that we have living in this borough. And I thank Jeanette really for highlighting the discretionary relief, the hardship fund, because there are people out there, I think, who don't know about it and are all really struggling, so thank you for that.
Sorry, Phil. I'd just like to amend the recommendation to reflect the 100% that we've come to, as opposed to
50%. Yeah, we've got that, yeah, thanks. Yeah, Bernie.
Obviously, I welcome what we're doing for our families. It just shows, it underpins, as I think it was Matt who said, children are at the heart of this, young people are at the heart. And you rightly say this government has abandoned. What they've done is they haven't abandoned all children, they've only abandoned the vulnerable children. And that's an absolute disgrace. But thank you for this. Everything is wonderful.
Can I just particularly also welcome, you've corrected the 100% discount for the refuge. I mean, you know, we had the debate on the Labour motion about domestic violence at the council last week, and this is a crucial area. I'm so pleased that we've been able to, A, we've got a refuge, and B, we've been able to agree a 100% discount. I think that's fantastic. So, well done, Jeanette, on that. Okay, so we've got the recommendations in front of us on pages 49 and 50 with our amendments around the refuge discount. Can we agree those recommendations?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, very much. Thank you, Jeanette. Okay, so I think that brings us to the end of the public business. We've got, I've not been notified of any other reports, we've got two reports in the exempt section, so I will move the appropriate resolution to exclude the press and the public. Is that seconded?
Seconded.
Is that agreed? Agreed, asked. Do you want to read this out? Okay, I'll read out the recommendation under section 100, bracket A, bracket 4, the Locum Act 1972, the public be excluded from the meeting during consideration of following items business on the grounds that they involve the likely disclosure of exact information as defined by paragraph 3 of part 1, schedule 12A, brackets as amended to that act. The public interest test has been applied and favours exclusion, and this is commercially sensitive information. That's the grounds. So, is that agreed? Okay.